So on this next one, why is there something rather than nothing? This is an age-old question. You know, everybody can look around and say, like, wow, where'd this all come from?
Right.
Right? My take is that we are just too ignorant to know. I mean, when you consider that right now scientists know about 4% of the universe is matter, and like 96% of it is dark energy and dark matter, and that means they have no clue actually what it is. We cannot see it. It's just in the equations. So there is so much we don't know. It's kind of like if Neanderthals were sitting around the campfire saying, what causes an earthquake? Well, let's use deductive logic. You know, we know that big animals, the bigger the animals, the more the ground shifts. So obviously there must be a big, huge, invisible thing that hits the ground, and that makes us the earthquake. And that, what is this big, invisible thing? Well, that's probably God. So they just didn't know about plate tectonics. There's no way they can come up with the answer.
Right.
So I think in the same way, we are just way too naive as a species to know. And I don't think we should jump to, oh, it's magic. You know, it's God. Gods are magical. Everything you can't explain is just magic. It's just God did it.
Yep. Well, I would say science is never going to answer that question. That philosophy, in particular classical philosophy, beautifully answers it. That the reason why there's something is because what we end up realizing is there ends up being some being that just is existence itself. And at the end, that's why I'm going to argue that God actually is identical to existence. Like, let's just say, I said, hey, Bernie, can I borrow a pen? And you said, sure, but I don't have one. Let me ask my friend John if I can borrow a pen. And John didn't have a pen, so he's going to borrow one from Bill. If you only have an infinite regress of borrowers, will I ever get the pen?
Right. Is this Clay Jones? I just heard Clay Jones talking about this. Is that where you got that from, or somebody else?
No. Okay. No, I got this from the Geiflers.
Oh yeah, okay, so they're saying, yeah, eventually you got to get it from, you can always borrow from somebody who borrowed it from somebody, but eventually somebody has to actually have it.
Yes, the thing is, if you have an infinite number of borrowers, you're never going to produce the pen. If you substitute pen with existence and say, I get my existence from Bernie, but if Bernie is the same kind of being that I am, and he gets his existence from John, who gets his existence from another, if every kind of being is the kind of being that gets its existence from another, what problem would we have? Just like I never get the pen, would I ever get existence?
Right.
I
so everything.
Right?
So I, you know, I agree with you completely that everything has to come from something that is eternal. I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah. So what we end up concluding is, whatever the thing is that's granting existence to the whole chain, that can't also be something that's dependent on a prior being for its existence.
Mm-hmm.
So that thing already has existence.
Right.
And it's got to be different from the whole chain. It has to be identical to existence itself.
Right.
Existence
okay.
is one of its attributes.
What's that?
Existence is one of its attributes.
Right,
existence
right.
Existence is not one of my attributes, though.
Right, right. Okay, I can follow that so far.
So if existence is one of its attributes, then it's not in existence, it's identical to existence. There's something, there's got to be a being that actually is existence itself.
But right there, you just made a leap that was unfounded when you say it's got to be a being. Why couldn't nature be eternal? For example, let me tell you what I'm thinking. For example, Dr. Krauss is now saying, you know, something from nothing. Basically, he's saying that it's possible for space and time to actually pop out of nothing, where there's no space, there's no time, and space and time could actually come into existence. So maybe it's possible that it's impossible. Maybe it's just impossible to have nothing as existence. Maybe existence, by definition, I mean, maybe it's just impossible to have non-existence.
Nothing as existence would be a contradiction.
What's that?
Nothing as existence would be a contradiction.
No, I'm saying maybe it's impossible to have non-existence.
Yeah. Well, first of all, when I say being, I don't mean a person. Being means, in classical philosophy, anything that bees, anything that exists.
So,
a rock has being, space has being.
So the multiverse, for example, if there's a multiverse, if there's just some kind of eternal something, that is not a mind, that is not a God, that could be a possibility, right?
Well, no, the multiverse is a collection of dependent universes. Our universe is dependent on a prior universe, dependent on a prior universe. There cannot be an infinite regress of dependent universes. There has to be something that's not the universe.
Well, the problem there is when you say infinite regress, you're talking about the infinite regress only goes back to the start of time, and that's the start of time at this Big Bang. So before the Big Bang, there's other multiverses. So
the other universes, if they're natural universes, they have the same nature ours does, so they have the same problem ours does.
No, if our universe popped in, that was a start of time. It came from something else before there was time.
Well, there can't be an infinite number of changes, an infinite number of causes or regresses. It's still the exact same logical problem. But there's got to be some independent being. And this thing, it can't be the universe because the universe has what we call potency, has potential. Kind of like I am an actual being and a potential being. I have the potential to exist, the potential to not exist, because at one time I didn't exist. I have the potential to sit down, to run, or whatever. Every potential being at one time was not an actual being. Okay, so something prior to me had to already be an actual being and then cause me to exist. So if you picture like a chain of potential beings, if every being is a potential being, and then it gets actualized by a prior existing being, you have a problem if everything is potential. Because a pure potential being, what would a pure potential being be?
Okay, but I think the thing you're missing is, let's say, for example, you trace back time to the very start at the Big Bang.
Yeah, but the argument I'm giving you actually goes beyond time. It actually has to do with your existence now.
No, it doesn't.
It actually has nothing to do with the Big Bang.
Well, you're talking about regressions going back eternal
no,
negative progressions.
You're thinking of what's called the Kalam horizontal cosmological argument. I'm giving you what's the vertical cosmological argument that has to do with your being right now. That don't picture it horizontally; picture it more vertically. That you are like links in a chain. Like you are a potential being, but you're also actually exist as well. But prior to that, you were pure potential, means you did not exist at all.
Well, okay. Let's take this.
Can you follow me on this really quickly? Because it's really important.
I'm not really following you, but you can continue.
Well, I want you to follow me. Okay, I want you to think. Before you existed, you were just a pure potential being. Something else.
Wait, before I existed, I wasn't nothing. I wasn't a potential anything. Before I existed, I was nothing.
But metaphysically, you had the potential.
No. Right. No, there was no me. You can't say I had potential.
Yes, pure potential means you don't exist. Pure potential means non-existent. But you really, in reality, did have the potential. That's why you're here. Like square triangles don't have the potential to exist, so they'll never actually exist. Right now, you actually exist, and you have the potential to exist. Because at one time, you had the potential, but you didn't actually exist. And the problem is, if you only have potential beings, they have to be actualized by something that's already actual. So what kind of being does that mean must exist? Are you following me on this?
Not really.
Okay. You are a potential being and an actual being, but something had to actualize you.
Something
so the thing that existed before you was actual and potential, then it also used to be a pure potential being.
I'm just thinking as you're talking, you know, before I was born, I mean, we can talk about all this in illustration to the Big Bang. You can trace everything back to the Big Bang.
Well, this would have to do with your existence right now. I'll go ahead and tell you the answer.
I mean, so the question is, what started the Big Bang? That's the next interesting question.
This is a stronger argument than the Big Bang argument. This would be, there has to be a being that has no potential and is what we call pure actuality. That being that has no potential, pure actuality, is what's going to bring into existence the first potential being that will become actual and potential. If you can kind of picture it like that, you have to have something that's pure actuality.
Well, I guess something
brings in
something that's
being.
Really throwing me off is when you keep on saying being, because it sounds like you're conflating you said that doesn't have to be a God, but it seems like
thing.
Whenever
I'll
you
say existing thing.
But whenever you say being, though, everybody's going to interpret that when they're listening as a God, and it sounds like you're talking about a God.
Yeah, that's why I define it. Well, go Google classical philosophy being. How about I say existing thing? There's got to be some existing thing that's what we call pure actuality and has no potential.
Well, we're out of time on this one. I'll give you just take a few seconds to summarize your point, and then we'll have to move on.
Yeah, I would say there's got to be something that's pure actuality, has no potential, and then acts to bring in the first potential beings. It cannot be the multiverse, because that's going to be potential, going to have changes and everything. Using the Kalam argument, there has to be something prior to the natural universe that acted, that brought it into existence, and that would be this uncaused, infinite, eternal, pure, actual, non-changing being that you exist in right now, that God is identical to existence.
Okay. You're wrong, but we'll just move forward.
I'm right. go look up Aquinas' five ways on the internet, and that way you can kind of follow it. It's very
deep. That poor guy didn't know anything about modern cosmology or modern physics, so he was, you know, you can't expect much out of him, like a Neanderthal, as far as I'm concerned.
That's an ad hominem fallacy. He doesn't know anything about science, so he's a bad philosopher.
He cannot draw reasonable modern conclusions with his ancient knowledge. That's
chronological snobbery. Look at you going with your fallacies. You said no fallacies tonight.
No, I don't think that's a fallacy at all. I mean, it's obvious he had no concept of modern cosmology. That's obvious.
Okay, you're confusing metaphysics with physics.
No, I don't.
Physics is based on metaphysics. You can't have one without the other.
I would say the other way around. I'd say metaphysics is based on the facts of the world, the physics. You have to know the basic facts of the world before you can start speculating about
metaphysics. You know what metaphysics is?
Yeah, about the existence of things.
Yeah, it's a study of existence and reality. So physics has to have the ability to be real and to exist. Like, when you study physics, you have to do metaphysics. Metaphysics is connected
No. There are people doing science that are totally naive, don't know anything about philosophy at all because they're just doing science.
They're using it. The scientific method is the philosophy of how to do science. Scientific method?
Okay. Well, we have to go on to the next topic.
All right.
Ready? Okay,
so I'm sure we'll do the bonus material at the end.
Yeah.
All right. It's fun, though, yeah?
All right, sure.
I can't see your face. I don't know what you're doing.
I think this is probably one of your favorite topics, right? The one we just did?
Yeah, and we got to move on from it. Oh, well.
I mean, in the future, maybe we can do just one show on that or something.
I'm
afraid of boring people, though. I mean, some people are like, I'm not interested in that topic, and now you're going off on it for an hour or so.
Yeah, we'll tell them to send us emails about what they want to hear, and then we'll just do all that the whole time.